toolbox.tk. If I go to manage freenom DNS, freenom domain, if you can recall, like, you know, last time the name server were defined as, I said, no, this time, this particular freenom should only be acting as, I'm not actually using domain Azure DNS. I want this particular server should be able to resolve my services one. So once I do this, if I go to manage freenom DNS now, it'll actually give me the option of adding the what the records. Why records? I'll tell you why. Let me show it to you why. But first, let's copy this coolbug.tk. Okay. Do not. You have to be very careful. Oh, sorry. I myself was not careful. You have to be very careful at the time of typing this. If the name is not correctly matching, coolbug.tk. This domain has to be a public domain registered somewhere. I don't know how, whether you procure it from any third-party domain register or you'll take it from freenom, but you have to have it. So once I'll actually have it, the domain here, I configured it as an alternative name. What does that mean? If I just show diagrammatically, what I did was using a third-party domain registrar. Let me show you domain registrar, which is in our case, it is freenom.com. So it is actually freenom. Freenom.com is the one which is actually acting as a domain registrar. It gave a domain to me as coolbugs.tk. This domain is that can be recognized to the rest of the world. So I can map this domain to this domain as mapped it as UPN suffix. This is what I did. What is the benefit of this? I'll tell you what is the benefit. But I mapped it this way. This is what I did. So I actually procured one domain called coolbugs.tk and I mapped it to this domain. So I've been to my VM, right click onto this, properties under Active Directory Domain Interest, and I mapped our UPN suffix. Now, what is the benefit coming out to be here? If I go to tools and if I go to Active Directory Users and Computer, okay, I don't know about you guys, but let's say I was the last time working upon CTS Power Incident. So I can actually say CTS.com. So if I right click onto the user, and say new, and if I say user, and if I create a user one, let's say I'm creating few user to show user one as a login name, and here in place of @example.local I will take @coolbugs.tk. that means I can also log in via this user through user1@coolbugs.tk from outside anywhere. But we have to wait to get it done. So I created one user. Locally, this user been configured under my domain called example.local. But I want this user can also be recognized from the rest of the world as user1@coolbugs.tk. So I gave a UPN suffix here. Like this is the same way I created a user two, and I gave some password. These are the local user I'm creating, guys, in my domain controller. Usually we create these user AD administrator create these user, like, you know, by running a PowerShell script, and they can create thousands and thousands of user within a at one go, you know. But we are not here to learn PowerShell for AD perspective. So I created three users. Remember, three users I've created, guys. User one, user two, user three. The other user called Amit is actually admin user of this machine. So in this machine, I created three users, and three users have been mapped as, if you just click onto account, you can see their UPN suffixes coolbugs.tk. Okay, because prior creating the user, I've been to tools, I've been to Active Directory Domain Interest, and there, you know, on the Active Directory Domain Interest properties, I added the UPN suffix as coolbugs.tk. Now, what does that mean? That means I actually wanted to map this particular domain, which has not been recognized. You know, my name can be any nickname at home, but I'm recognized to the rest of the world as Amit Sharma. So that's my formal name. That's a local name which can be used only by my family. Now, if I wanted to do, you know, this particular domain represent this forest to the rest of the world, and this particular, you know, domain represent this forest part, which is this domain of this forest. So I need to establish a relationship between this to this. So this is a trust relationship. I need explicit trust relationship relation to be established, so that the users of this particular domain can access the resources of this particular domain of Azure, something like that. Take an example, you know, companies like that have got thousands and thousands of users worldwide spread across into their Active Directory. And now the company has been using, like, you know, that most of the resources they are deploying onto the cloud. So will they be migrating all those users one by one to the cloud? Rather, what they will do is they will establish a trust in between one forest and the second forest, like this. So the user of or resources of this particular forest can be synced into this forest. This is what we wanted to do. Now, to do an explicit trust relationship, I need to go to my portal, and here I have to go to Active Directory, and in the Active Directory I have to go to there's something called custom domains. I've got my own domain already mentioned as, that domain is Amit Sharma MCP Outlook as a part of onmicrosoft.com. That is my domain. I hope you all will be having your own subdomains. I have to click on to custom domain. This domain has to be the domain which has to be public domain. You can't give example.local here. So here you have to give something called coolbugs.tk, because I want to know coolbugs.tk is then representing example.local publicly. So I will add the domain. When I'll add the domain, this way anybody can add accenture.com, cth.com. Microsoft says wait, halt. To let me determine that the domain which you've added is the one which you own. And if you own that domain, you actually have to make an entry into your domain registrar, this entry, either text entry or MX record entry. So I have to select this MX record entry, copy this entry, go to my freenom.com. I hope let me. You also have to look for Freenom is actually very, very, you know, dangerous site in terms of, like, you know, that sometimes it misfire. So you have to take care of these things that, you know, sometimes it doesn't work. Just see, I changed that, but it did not take that. Change name servers. I did it and then still it is not showing me that. Come on, nonsense. Now it is showing me the text record here, and I will just enter that MS record and just say save and save changes. So being into my domain called coolbugs.tk, I added this text record entry and the code has been saved successfully. Now I have to wait for some time to actually get my domain verified by Microsoft. So that sometimes take like, one to two, 2 to 3 minutes, and sometimes it takes 10 minutes also. So you can't help it. So if I click on to verify, and if I'll be too hurry, sometimes I'm very lucky, very much lucky, but I know I will not be. So it will give me an error or by saying that could not find a DNS record for this domain. DNS change may take up to 72 hours, but do not get disheartened. It shows you that, that's the maximum time. But sometime within few minutes only, it will work. So till the time this domain will not validate, I can't do anything. But what I have done here is I can depict it with the diagram. And this is my diagram. Do you understand this diagram? If anybody has got the issue, please do let me know. And I hope my voice is not fumbling or cracking, and my screen is also not lagging. Can anybody respond? Are we good up till now? Okay. What about Amrendra, Hemant, Asad? Are you guys following it side by side? Or at least you are understanding what I've done? Can I get your poll as well, along with Kevin? Okay. So let me try my luck again by going back and do verification. The verification still not happened. Meanwhile, let me actually go back to my VM. This is my VM. This has got AD and DNS installed. Local server is VMDC. And if I just go and just enable the browsing by disabling the ICE and I enhance security here. Now what I need to do is that I need to actually install, once the relationship has been established, which I'm waiting for to be established. Meanwhile, I would require one tool which will be able to sync. What I now, once the relationship has been established, this is the first step. Once the relationship has been established, then I will use something called AD Connect, one of the tool. Something like this will be installed here onto your machine. This tool will do what? It'll actually sync. Sync users, groups, devices. And password using hash synchronization. So this tool is called AD Connect. It need to be installed on your machine, maybe, you know, in your domain environment. It can be, usually AD administrator will not give you a privilege of installing the anything onto the domain controller. So you may install it onto your one of your member server, but you require this connect to be installed somewhere. Using AD Connect, what will happen? It will actually sync users, group, devices, you know, from your on-premises domain to your Azure subscription, so that user can get authenticated against Azure. Okay, their resources can be, you know, recognized or can be authorized from your on-premises domain. In that case, we can use ADFS. It is beyond the scope of the training. We can do it, but right now this is our lab which we want to do. So to actually, first I need to have the explicit relationship established. Right now the verification is not happened. So this particular domain called Coolbox, which is mapped with example.local, is not been recognized by Microsoft. Microsoft will say, who are you? I don't recognize you. So AD Connect will not work. So first I need to actually ensure when I go here and you know, I'll just show you, I wanted to show you the error also. So that's the reason I'm actually doing it first. I'm not waiting for the domain to get verified, because I want to show you the error. Azure AD Connect download. If you download this tool, usually we install it onto the member server, but I don't have a second server. So I'm deploying it onto AD domain controller, main domain controller. It's actually a dangerous thing. Microsoft AD administrator will not let you do it ever. And in fact, they are the one who will be going to do all these things what we are seeing right now. So maybe you will never be given this chance. So this is a 90 MB tool approximately. And once you download and you run this tool, pretty simple tool, it's not difficult. Once you actually start running, you know, it will, after installation, it will actually ask you to configure it. So AD Connect is starting. Sometimes it runs in the tray icon. So you just have to go to tray icon and click onto that. It will show you the wizard. So first wizard is actually the welcome wizard. You know, you can read about that. It is nothing great. It will only tell you, installation guide will tell you how to select the solution, which is password, hash synchronization or federation. What do you want to do? So we don't want to do a kind of, you know, two different Active Directory. We don't have two different Active Directory service. At one end, we have something called Azure AD. This is our Azure AD we are using. This is AD, not directory service. And on premises, we have DS, ADDS. So basically, this is ADDS at on-premises level. And here we are doing something called, this is actually Azure AD. So Azure AD is IAM tool. So from directory service, we are integrating our directory services, which is actually on-premises directory service. We are integrating that directory service to Azure AD, which is actually an IAM tool, which is for identity and access management, only for authentication, access management tool. So this is what we want to sync. We can actually sync two different directory services also, which I told you in my notes that Azure ADDS is a separate service. Let me tell you while something is happening at the back. So if you look for something called Active Directory, there's something called Azure Active Directory, and there's something called Active Directory, the directory service. So two services have been there. So ADDS is different than Azure Active Directory. Azure Active Directory is what we are using here. This is what? This is an IAM tool. ADDS is that you are deploying directory service onto the cloud also. So in that case, one directory service running in the on-premises is integrating the directory service running in the cloud. So for that, we can do federation. But right now we are not up to that prediction. So what we'll do is, it says if you have a single Windows server active for us, I have single Windows active server for us. So what I can do is, what it will do is, it will configure synchronization for the identities from custom AD for us. It also configure password hash synchronization from on-premises AD to Azure AD. That means password will also be synced, but using hash synchronization. That means password will be hashed and will be stored under Azure AD for security purpose. It'll also start initial synchronization and will synchronize all the attribute of the users group whichever has been getting synced. So if I say use express setting, because I've got a single domain right now, the first thing it will ask me to connect to the is Azure AD. Please understand, when you connect to Azure AD, how do you connect to Azure AD? Whenever you connect to a portal, you have been connecting to a portal. You know, let's take an example. If I go to Firefox, another browser altogether, which may not have a credential of mine, of my portal credential. Let me check if I'm lucky. So it may actually ask me to enter my credentials. Yep. So if I'm not actually having the credential, let's say if I forget this. So I have to enter my credential, and those credential will be, you know, my amitsharma.mcp@outlook.com. This is the one which actually I registered my subscription with. But here it is expecting to connect to Azure AD, you have to enter Azure AD global admin credential. And that global admin credential should have the username pattern as whatever your domain .onmicrosoft.com. That means I have to create a user. Just listen it carefully, my point. I have to go to my Azure AD, and here I have to go to users. When you'll be going to user, you'll be having only single user. So I'll be creating one more user here. Create user. I'll give the user. Let's say I'm creating a user with the name sample. User is sample. You know, you can give any name to it. And it says password will be automatically generated. This password will be temporary password. So we have to change it somewhere later. So I will change it. And one more thing, if you see, it says this user has to be global administrator. That means this will user which I'm creating should not be a normal user. So it should have a role of not a normal user. So I have to click onto user to select predefined role given here from Azure AD. So one of the role is global admin. Let me go to global admin. This is the one. Select. And I create this user. After creating this user, I have to go to my browser where, because I don't want to sign out, sign in again and again. So here I need to type that user sample, but I can't type @outlook.com. Why? Because if you can see somewhere in my here, the username is sample@amitsharmamcp.outlook.onmicrosoft.com, almost an essay. So I have to go all the way. Why? First time I have to log in here. So I have to say amitsharmamcp.outlook.onmicrosoft.com. I hope I'm correct. And then I use that password which I was given. The password was temporary password which I got. If the password has been correct, it asks me to change the password. I'll type the current password and then I'll use a new password. And now with that user called sample as a global admin, I will be able to get into a portal. But one more thing, I have to show it to you guys. See it carefully. Unlike this portal, wherein you actually have, I'm logged in here as a Amit, my Outlook credential. If I just show you all resources here. So I got multiple resources configured here. So far in the lab, multiple web app, multiple VMs, load balancer, you know, VM specific virtual network and all those stuff. But on the other hand, if I just go to, I'm also super admin here. Sample is the super admin, global admin. If he goes and if he says all resources, nothing comes. What does that mean? This user has been authenticated, but is not authorized for the subscription under which the resource has been configured. To illustrate that example, if I go back to my Chrome, if I go back to here, subscription, remember the subscription first day I told you, subscription, I got my subscription, you may have Azure subscription, you know, password or for student. So I go to subscription and I go to access control. And to that subscription, I add a user here, add role assignment. And I'll add that user a role of owner to that user called sample and save it. As soon as this user will be added, after a while, what will happen is, you know, that user which has been added as a subscription owner, okay, earlier he was not been shown any kind of resource. Now they will be shown the resources. It may take a while, so you have to be patient. Because role takes time to reflect, you know, things properly. So I've given that user called sample as an owner role. So it may take a while to actually reflect that user to act as a owner. And when he's been acting as an owner, when he'll go back to refresh, and now I think he'll be able to see it. If you go back to all resources, sometime it takes time. So guys, I told you, just see. Can you see, guys? So in this case, what I've done is I've created a user. That user was actually been made as a AD user. I created into Azure AD. Okay, this is not an idle situation. Only for sync purpose, I have done it. And that user I've created a kind of, when I create that user as a global admin, I just wanted to show you that being a global admin, till the time he doesn't have the access of the resources, okay, till the time he will not have an access of the subscription under which the resources are built. So my resources are being built under subscription of mine, which is MSDN subscription. The moment I give the ownership of MSDN subscription to that user, which I just created as a global admin, the user will be able to see all the build resources which are built against my subscription. Just see, this is a traffic manager which has been built against MSDN subscription. You can check the subscription is. So that means a user who's actually a global admin in Azure may not have access of all the resources unless Azure AD administrator will actually assign him some level of permission. So please understand, Azure AD admin will never give the ownership to other users. Only limited user will be becoming Azure AD administrator as an owner. The rest of them can become contributor, can become reader, and can actually utilize different resource specific ownership. But subscription level ownership is dangerous to be given to every user. It can do blunder for every user. If you actually give it to every user, can be very dangerous, can be very harmful. I've just shown you, like, you know, that first step was to create a user as a global admin. And second step was to actually give him the subscription level access. That is an authorization. So why I did it is just to show you something that I have to actually add here, sample at the rate Amit Sharma MCP Outlook dot on Microsoft dot com, and I'll give the password which I changed. And if this user is a global admin, and if this user has been found there under Azure AD with the rights of global admin, I'll we move to other users. Can you see connecting to online to verify the credential, and then it is checking whether the user is a global admin or not. And now it is going to the second step, which is connecting to Azure ADDS. My Azure ADDS is example is my domain, and my domain admin was Amit. I hope I correct. I pass the correct password, and then if I say next, that's what I was aware of. Like that, I'm too confident on typing sometimes. Did I do it correct? Sure. Just give me a second. Don't tell me I've changed the password. Example / Smith. This is correct. Username is not, password is not correct. Okay, no problem. I can change the password also. Just give me a second, okay? I have to go to dsa.msc. I'm into domain. No, dsa.msc here. I'll just select my username. Reset password with finger crossed. Just give me a second, I'll just type it very slowly. Don't tell me. Thankfully. So I type correct password. Now just see here, example.local, which is a, this domain has got a suffix as example.local, and one is coolbug.tk. None of them is verified. I keep on verifying it, it will never be verified. The reason being, if I go to my portal, go to Active Directory, I hope you remember, like, you know, we added custom domain. And we were in a process of verifying this. It is unverified. If I click now, and if I just look for verify, keep my finger crossed. If the domain has been replicated, it will be verified. You can check here, verification domain succeeded. If the verification happened, if I go back to the custom verified, it is verification succeeded here. Now, if I just go, you know, and wait, just see here. It has been verified. This will never be, you know, verified. The reason being, I need to create this domain as a public domain. So it's a local domain. It'll never be verified. So in that case, I can say continue without matching all the utilities. In this case, what will happen? Only those user which has been mapped with coolbugs.tk will be synced. So if I just say next and install. Now, behind the scene in this machine, it will install a SQL Server Express database. This database will ensure, like, you know, that you know, any kind of change which will happen into the synchronization. Synchronization is actually a incremental service. So it will actually only look for delta changes. So any kind of user which is actually in a process of being synced next time, it will only sync that. So to determine that what all users and what all objects have been synced so far, it actually maintain a database. so that next time when during sync, it will only pick the delta changes from the on-premises AD to the Azure AD. And please understand, this whole synchronization right now we are doing is actually a one-way sync. In order to do a two-way sync, that means you should be able to sync the data from, let me show you the diagram. In this diagram, the sync is happening from here to here. From here to here. This is actually explicit one-way relationship. So that means the resources are being synced from this on-premises to here. If you want to do, like, you know, that the changes which have been done here should also be synced here. So in that case, you require something called Azure AD versions. So you got four type of versions of Azure AD, guys, as per the pricing model of Azure AD. And if you look for the pricing model, one which we are using in our subscription is free. It'll only give only 5 lakhs employees, 500,000 objects can be synced from on-premises to Azure AD. Here, if you purchase Office 365 subscription for Azure AD, then no object limit, and you can sync up till 10 applications. But here, if you take premium one, premium two version of Azure AD, then limit is endless. Premium two is faster, but it actually is. If you have got, take an example, Accenture has got 4,68,000 employees. 4,68,000 employees, and per employee, 594 per month. How much they have to pay? They take premium version 2. So not everyone actually utilizes the premium version 2. You have to also look for, like, you know, what all feature you are actually availing from the Azure AD premium version. So sometimes, like, you know, some people are very happy with free version also. Some people are only happy with, I'm talking about those users. So apart from the user, you can have group also, you can have, like, you know, devices also. So they definitely will go beyond 500,000 than the 4,28,000 only users. So in that case, you know, Accenture had to go either for Office 365 or premium version. They are actually using premium version 1. So the rest was, you know, that, you know, how to work with Azure AD is actually a different 3-day course only for those guys, those who are very good with Azure, sorry, with Active Directory. They are champion in Active Directory, has been working upon Active Directory, you know, in and out. Their only job is to work with Active Directory, and they wanted to integrate properly with Active Directory. So this is just a lab of integrating on-premise AD with Azure AD as an IAM tool. We are not doing ADDS to ADDS integration right now. We have just done Azure ADDS to Azure, sorry, on-premises ADDS to Azure AD integration. That's what we have done as per this diagram, whatever has been depicted here. This is what we have achieved, guys. And once it will be done, you can actually see here that VM has actually show you configuration is complete. Now you can log into Azure. So if I just exit from here, just go back to my portal. Let me go back to my portal. And if I click here onto Azure Active Directory and show you the user, soon you'll be able to see user 1, user 2, user 3 from Coolbox has come. And if I just go to my Firefox browser or any other browser, third party browser, if I sign out from here, and now I will sign it from that user called user 1. User 1. So I need not to give here user 1 @ Amit Sharma MCP. No need. This user actually been synced from the on-premises. And on-premises AD user was user 1 @ example.local. But example.local will not be recognized. So in that case, this user has been given a UPN suffix with a public domain. The public domain has been verified by Azure AD. You can check here. Public domain has been verified by Azure AD as a custom domain. Let me show it to you somewhere here. You just saw that. It's been verified. So any user from this domain which will be coming will be verified if it is synced. So user one is already synced. So if I just say coolbugs.tk, and if I pass the password which I gave that to that user at the time of creating the user under on-premise AD, so user will be logged in. at least authentication has happened. But this user, as a normal user, again will not be given any kind of subscription level rights. And that's where the authorization, the next level comes. To give the access to the resources, you know, I have to go all the way to my normal Azure AD administrator. I'm an Azure AD administrator and owner. I have to go to my subscription, as I said earlier. I have to go to my subscription, select my subscription. I have to go to access control. And here I have to add the user as a role assignment. And I will add the user. Contributor means he can do anything. And he can also give other permissions, other users also permission to access the resources. Contributor, on the other hand, we can do everything, but he cannot give the access to other resources, access to the resources to other users. But I wanted to give the user one and user two as a reader. As I'm creating the user one as a, and user one and user two as a reader. So let me just select user one and one more. You can add user two as a reader. So being a user, when user one or user two, let's say I'm signing out from here, I'll sign in with the user two or user one also. I have to wait, so I can also sign in. I can show you here, coolbugs.tk. Correct password. Yeah. And if I just go to all resources, I can see the resources. Okay, soon I will be able to see the resources. Can you see? But if I select the resource and try modifying that resource, or maybe if I even go to a normal resource group and I try creating a new resource group, you know, people will be wondering, oh, what will happen. If I try creating a new resource group as RG3, what it says? It says you don't have permission to create resource group under this subscription, because I'm actually been given a role of a reader. A reader cannot do anything except only monitoring whatever has been running in the subscription. So you can give different level of subscription to the user which has been synced. But take an example, thousands and thousands of user in the on-premises can be synced at one go using Azure AD Connect. That's what is we did. That's what was the diagram. This is the diagram. And that's what was the diagram here. You can check. This also is the same thing. What I did was I created a kind of Azure Active Directory services by creating a domain controller. Okay. And then what I did was that example.local was mapped with the coolbugs.tk in this case. This coolbug.tk I actually took as a public domain from Freenom. This is Freenom, not Freedom. This Grammarly actually creates a problem sometimes. Then I have to map this public domain to the example.local. After this particular public domain need to be mapped under Azure AD using custom domain mapping. That's what I establish a trust relationship, and that is actually one-way relationship. And after doing that, this AD Connect tool, which I'm using, this AD Connect tool, the users of on-premises can be synced under Azure AD. That's what we did. I hope you understood my lab. Did you understand up till now? Anybody has question from whatever we have done so far in this diagram? You know, steps can be followed by you later also, in case if you've not been able to follow it side by side, because you'll get the recording of this session. But can you tell me whatever we have seen somewhere here practically, are you gone through with this diagram? Did you understand what we have done, what we are up to? Am I audible or and nobody responds? No, book will not talk about integration properly. The reason being, book will consider that you have a valid domain. If you wanted to know how to create a valid domain, and that to free domain, sorry, you can be in touch with me. I told you the site. Yeah. And rest. You guys are intelligent enough of registering a domain from that site. Register yourself, get one domain freely available. Don't take .com, .org, .edu. Since it's a free site, it will not give you those commercial domains. That is the reason, John, I told you, like, you know, that there's no lab and they only explain theoretically. So normally when I cover the training in person, I show the lab and people also follow with me when they are in person training, which happens. So in this case, what happens is we have got limited time. At the same point in time, you know, there are a lot of things, a lot of people are actually up to the books and all those stuff. When I cover these kind of training in person, I will always ask them to actually go through with the books by themselves or the PPT by themselves via following the book, so that they can completely focus upon practical side by side with me. And later on, they can actually ask me the question from the books or from any PPT if they have. So this is the reason why I follow this practice. And believe me, this practice works for everyone, at least in India, I've seen, and outside India also. Wherever I've taken the session via e-learning, you know, this lab, usually people don't show it. Try showing them exactly how it works. So if you follow the recording session of mine and slow it down, pause it wherever you actually need some time, and then do it accordingly. If you have any kind of challenge, still I will be an email away from you guys. this is the integration part. If you look for module, this is actually telling you what is Azure AD, what does it do, what are different editions of AD. I told you, the premium 1, 2, Outlook 365, and be free. The AD directory benefit, what is the benefit of the directory? I told you, Active Directory, Azure Active Directory, if you look for quickly, let's just to recap, because I have to show you another lab of another module. So let's quickly recap about the slide. So Azure Active Directory is a multi-tenant. Yes, everybody of us, every one of us are actually been tenant of on Microsoft.com. It provides SSO, single sign-on. I'll show you that example also of single sign-on. It also let you integrate with the Windows Server Active Directory. That's what we did. We had an on-premises directory created as a simulated Active Directory domain services, and we integrated with the Azure Active Directory. The last step, the last point. The benefit of this directory service being an IAM tool, it offers you single sign-on. I hope you've been aware of single sign-on. In single sign-on, there are three parties involved. One is identity provider, one is site provider, and one is claim provider. So this particular directory service actually acts as an identity provider. It gives a valid identity to the user. And your web application can become a site provider. Active Directory, Azure Active Directory is compatible with any particular device which want to get authenticate their application against Azure Active Directory. Authenticate, please do understand, authenticate, not authorize. You can protect on-premises web application with this remote access. You can extend Azure, your Active Directory, on-premises Active Directory to the cloud by using, this is what I told you when I was telling you something about text editor here, that Azure AD only gives you extension capability of extending on-premises Active Directory directory service. So you can integrate these two. This is what we've done, step one. We have not done step two. Step two is not a part of your lab. It takes approximately 1 day to actually cover that lab. So we don't have that much time. 1 day means 8 hours. In our case, it will be 2.5 days. Azure AD is a identity solution, identity access management solution, as I said, and designed for only such application which actually can be communicated over HTTP or HTTPS. So application which has been queried upon REST API, rather than using LDAP, they can actually work on Azure AD to authenticate themselves. I will show it to you also. Okay. Azure AD stores the users and groups in a flat, stores them in the flat structure. Unlike, because in the, anybody who knows like about the Azure, sorry, on-premises directory service, ADDS. ADDS actually is a hierarchical database. But Azure AD is not hierarchical database, it's a flat structure. So it doesn't actually offer you, unlike normal AD, unlike so far what all you have worked upon Active Directory, Azure Active Directory doesn't offer you the concept of OUs. They don't offer you group policy object. They offer you four type of editions. That's what it is telling you. The awesome capability has been under this, and there are many things. If you are actually good with the AD parts, you can understand what all feature they are offering. You know, we actually call it as a edition which has been used by enterprise mobility solution. So for enterprise mobility solution, we make use of premium version 2 edition. Awesome. But it's very, very dangerous and very, very difficult to cover. I've only covered 2 tries for the client. And it's so difficult training that not everyone can cover it. And that's the reason I actually charge them very high. So just for a joke purpose. So here, if you look for this particular, you are tenant, I am a tenant. So in Azure AD, you being a tenant, you'll have your own subdirectory under on Microsoft.com. like I had Amit Sharma MCP dot on my Amit Sharma MCP Outlook dot on Microsoft.com. You may be having your own tenant ID. And the resources of one tenant cannot access the resources of other. Okay. It can be done, but explicitly it has to be done. And I told you that the usage of AD Connect. AD Connect is basically a tool which actually does what? Integrates the on-premises directories with Azure AD. That's what is the intent of Azure AD Connect, nothing else. It actually take all the OUs from on-premises AD and connect it and sync it here. So if you can recall in my case also, in my cloud here, if I just been to my Azure Active Directory, after sync, the user which has been coming here, user 1, 2, 3 users actually have been synced. One user I created for, you know, global admin, and one user has been actually a sync account. This is a sync account. And if I show you in my VM end, this is a VM, which is like, you know, which is simulating on-premises. In the on-premises end, if I just open here, sync, we can see synchronization service and synchronizer rule editor. So if I look for synchronization service, this is my Azure synchronization service. It is telling you that one of the connector which has been installed is installed onto my local domain. And one connector has been installed here onto my on Microsoft.com, and they've been connected. And what all have been added from on-premises to Azure is 10 resources. Now, please understand, out here we have actually got one user, two user, three user, and one more user, four user. How come it is telling you 10? So if you look for 10, what all 10 things have been synced? So it is telling you what all 10 things has been synced. Some user, which is actually at the background users, have been synced. And then actually I can configure all these things, like in the sync service, on-premises service here, synchronization rule editor. In the rule editor, anybody who's actually been good in writing the rules, he can decide what has to be, what type of users, what type of OUs, what type of group, what type of devices from your on-premises to be synced to Azure. So for that, you can write a rule, synchronization rules. So next time in the synchronization, during synchronization, the synchronization rule will come into account. Synchronization interval by default is actually 1 hour. And we can change it also. So my point is, like, you know, that AD Connect is one of the very good tool which has been offered. That's what it is telling you. We got password hash synchronization, which can synchronize all the password of your on-premises user with a hashed password. That means password will be stored in a hash manner, not an actual password. So even Azure AD admin cannot see your password because it has been hashed by Microsoft. Microsoft also gives you something called Active Directory Federation Services, which is actually using this service. We can federate what to be synced from here to here. So you can actually go through with this particular slide, which is nothing more than password hash synchronization. Let me show you the example of it. Prior coming on to this, I have to show you something about my Active Directory here. And here there is an option called under users. You'll see something called multi-factor authentication here. If I click onto the multi-factor authentication, I'll be taken to another portal. And here I will select for which all user I have to enable the multi-factor authentication. So enable user 1, user 2, user 3, and I enable it. After enabling the multi-factor authentication, what I can do out here is, whenever any user will be going to get authenticated, you know, against your portal. So portal will demand, just see it carefully. If I sign out from here, from Firefox, from the user one, and I ask him to sign in with the user one again, and if the user one will pass the password, just see earlier after passing the password, he was directly shifted to a portal. But now